Blackstone Audio presents Outer Perimeter by Ken Goddard. This book is read by Kevin Kenerly. This book is dedicated to Terry, my treasured brother-in-law, who faced and fought the outer perimeter with courage and humor and good faith, in a manner that can only be described as heroic. My sincere thanks to Bob, Naomi, Jody, and Terry, who continue to provide the critical inspiration for this ongoing story, and to Gina, Michelle, Ed, Elliot, Bucky, Judy, and Gina, who checked facts, figures, context, fantasy, and spelling with unfaltering good humor. And last, but certainly not least, to Anne Grohl, my dear editor, who worked the final manuscript into much better shape and was trusting and patient beyond belief. For the folks who don't happen to reside in the beautiful and infinitely variable state of Oregon, and therefore might be curious, as well as skeptical, there is no Banku Indian tribe living inside or out of the equally fictitious county of Jasper, Oregon. Both are simply artifacts of my imagination, and the latter, a place where I can create havoc with my characters amongst the local authorities and politicians without risking a felony traffic stop or subpoena. In this same regard, I have no reason to think my real-life special agent buddy, Bob Dawson, is actually flying Apache helicopters for any federal agency, or that the NSA has been busy constructing extraterrestrial research centers in or around ethereal Jasper County landscape, which, if it did exist, would probably be tucked away in some clever space-time warp fold, just a little north of Jackson, Josephine, and Klamath counties, and perhaps just a bit south of Douglas and Deschutes, which is pretty much where you'd also find the 12th Circuit Court. But as for the Cray Sacks themselves and their army of fervent believers, well, it is a big universe out there. And this is, after all, Oregon. Ken Goddard. Hallucination, an extremely rare phenomenon in which a completely convincing reality surrounds a person with his eyes open, a reality that he alone can experience and interact with. Alexander Shulgin and Anne Shulgin, Tikal, Places in the Mind, Transform Press, 1997. Prologue. "I'm sorry, sir," the dispatcher said in a professionally patient voice, "but we never release the home phone numbers or duty schedules of our officers. If you'd like to leave a message, I'll be happy to transfer you to his voicemail." "But I've already done that many—" Patrick Bergeon started to say in an exasperated voice, then shook his head. "Yes, please." Bergeon waited for the automated message system to wind through its routine, then spoke carefully into the mouthpiece. "Hello, Detective Sergeant Colin Cellars. This is Patrick Bergeon calling once again, and I'm hoping you will be able to call me back very soon. It is most important that I speak with you. It is Saturday now, and the time is—" he glanced down at his wristwatch— "almost 10 o'clock in the morning. I'm here in Jasper Springs at the Wind Shelter Lodge. Please call me here, or on my cell phone, as soon as you can." He recited the phone numbers, hung up the phone, then turned his attention back to the screen of the small television on his motel room dresser. It had been threatening rain all morning, and the predictions were getting worse. 4 to 5 inches now, with plenty of thunder and lightning to make things interesting, according to the weatherman, who stood next to a wall-sized satellite map with a glum look on his face. The colorful graphics showed why. Another massive cold front dropping down fast out of British Columbia, bringing with it a typical Canadian mix of sleet, snow, and negative temperatures. Within 24 to 36 hours, according to the weatherman, the rain and groundwater would start turning into ice and slush, thereby making life miserable for anyone unfortunate enough to be out on the roadways. Bergeon got up from the thinly padded motel room chair, pulled back the drapes to stare out at the darkening thunderheads, sighed deeply, then went back to his chair. He used the remote to scan through the available channels, finally settling on an old black-and-white western. By 10:30 a.m., the sidewalks around the small town of Jasper Springs, Oregon, were almost completely deserted as the local residents remained indoors, waiting patiently for the predicted downpour to begin. At 11 a.m., the winds began to pick up, and by 11:15, the ionic concentrations in the air had become more noticeable. But still, no rain, and still no response from detectives.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.